Penguin Random House Audio presents The Hunger Habit, Why We Eat When We're Not Hungry, and How to Stop. This is the author, Judson Brewer. To Jackie, Rob, and to all who have had fraught relationships with food. Introduction. Jackie's story. Jackie, a 40-something dog-loving yoga and mindfulness instructor, felt like a fraud. Even as she led her students through classes on acceptance and equanimity, she was hiding the fact that her own heart was far from tranquil. Beneath her calm exterior, she was battling a toxic cycle of shame, numbed by secret eating, which cycled back and fed more shame. She feared she was losing not just the battle, but the war with herself. Jackie's complicated relationship with food went as far back as she could remember. As a child, she'd been a slow and picky eater. Her well-meaning parents used to encourage her to eat more and be quick about it, so she tried to please them by picking up the pace and quantity of the food she ate. When Jackie hit puberty, her body started filling out along the lines of the rock star Pink's. When Jackie looked in the mirror, she didn't feel like a rock star. Instead, she felt dismay. She didn't want to look curvy or muscular. She wanted to look willowy and ethereal, more Gwyneth Paltrow than Pink. Jackie wasn't overweight, but like so many adolescent girls bombarded by images of slender celebrities and models like Kate, nothing tastes as good as skinny feels, Moss, she felt life would be happier if only she could be thinner. To reach her goal, she started restricting the amount and types of food she ate. Instead of ordering fries and a soda when she went out with friends, she'd order salad and drink water. Her careful food choices did leave her thinner, but not necessarily happier. During her teenage years, Jackie started spending more time with her friend Alice. Alice had recently lost a family member and was going through a period of depression. Jackie could relate. She seemed to feel bad about herself all of the time. Together, the friends realized they could numb some of their miserable feelings with food, a lot of food, eaten all at once. They began binging wildly, smothering their negative emotions with chocolates, cake, and fries, all foods Jackie had been so careful to avoid in her quest for a thinner body. Because binging didn't solve all their problems, Jackie and Alice also added cigarettes and alcohol for good measure. As Jackie got older, she went back to eating less and less so she could maintain what she felt was a normal weight. Before long, her focus on restricted eating became a full-time obsession. She thought about food, especially the food she was keeping herself from eating, all day, every day. It was as if her brain had been hijacked by these intrusive thoughts. She needed to take control again before she crashed, so she doubled down on her careful eating. She got so good at restricting what she ate, she could go the entire year following a strict diet, but then would have an epic blowout binge at Christmas. Restricting her eating to this extreme worked, sort of. Jackie stayed slim and told herself she was in control of her food, which made her feel in control of her life. That lasted until she quit smoking at the age of 30. Without the help of nicotine as a stimulant and appetite suppressant, she quickly put an additional 40 pounds on her 5'2" frame, and her feelings of failure came rushing back. Family and friends didn't help matters. She caught them looking at her critically when they thought she wouldn't notice and could swear they were whispering judgmentally about her behind her back. Sometimes they didn't even bother to hide it. One particularly harsh day, a family friend poked her in the stomach and said, "Wow, look how much weight you've piled on." As cruel as the world could be to her, it was nothing to how Jackie heaped shame upon herself. There were times where she felt utterly worthless. Jackie couldn't keep going this way. By the time she was 35, her restrict, binge, restrict cycle shortened from a year to months to weeks to daily. Monday morning would be her restrictive period when she carefully counted calories and managed what she ate, but by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, all bets were off. She would gorge on whatever she could get her hands on, donuts, chips, Chinese takeout, and then start over again the next day. Her restriction would inevitably collapse back into the binging and self-judgment. As bad as she felt about her weight, she felt worse about the fact that she had let herself get so out of control. Binging again was the only way for her to escape those terrible feelings, if only for a moment. After a nighttime binge, she would wake up choked with guilt. She would turn to her partner in bed and ask, "What's wrong with me?" She felt like a failure. She felt broken. And what's worse, she couldn't see a way out of the cycle. Jackie is far from alone in her tortured relationship with food. In my practice as a psychiatrist, I have seen as many different ways to have a bad relationship with food as I have patients. Many of my patients have become so hopelessly out of touch with their bodies, they cannot even tell if they're hungry or are simply eating their emotions. Some people come to me because they cannot seem to resist eating a bad food no matter how hard they try. Others just can't stop eating once they've taken that first bite. More than one patient has come to me desperate to control their mindless eating. I've seen people who micromanage each morsel they put in their mouths, carefully counting out 7 almonds at exactly 11 a.m., weighing their kale salad, scrupulously avoiding sugar until 7 p.m., when they'll tear open a bag of potato chips and devour the whole thing. For many, thoughts of food crowd out nearly everything else, making it difficult for them to notice, let alone enjoy, what's going on in their lives. To cope, some of my patients try to impose strict rules for themselves. No oil, no salt, no sugar, no fast food. Only to find that these rules make them feel as if they've constructed a cell and locked themselves up in food jail. As varied as these specifics are, these patients all have one thing in common. They feel bad about themselves. Actually, they feel terrible about themselves. They suffer from a rogues gallery of feelings ranging from frustration, guilt, and annoyance to despair, disgust, and self-loathing. It is painful for me to observe my patients in such agony. Typical diet advice makes the solution to their problems sound so simple: eat fewer calories. However, I have patients who come into my office week after week carrying their diligently recorded accounts of what they've eaten and how much they've exercised, and they're as miserable as ever. The reality is, for most people, no amount of calorie counting makes a difference. In medical school, I had been taught that good eating and weight management is nothing more than a question of calories in, calories out. All I had to do was point out to my patients that if their relationship with food was bad, they could just eat more salad and lay off the cake while exercising more. And voila, they'd lose weight. One of my medical school professors stated it matter-of-factly as if it were one of Newton's laws of motion. Follow the formula and the results were guaranteed. My patients didn't need a juicer or an elaborate meal plan. They didn't even need me. They needed a calculator. But it turned out that real life is not so simple. When I started my psychiatric practice, I could not immediately see what was happening with my patients that made them feel so dreadful. I've seen people in deep anguish because their struggles with food are every bit as vexing and destructive as those of my patients with other afflictions, including addictions to heroin, gambling, sex, or alcohol. The difference, of course, is unlike drinking alcohol or smoking cigarettes, which are optional behaviors, at least at first, eating is essential for our survival. There had to be a better way to handle food issues. I did what I was trained to do as a researcher. I investigated the problem. I started by looking carefully at the standard approaches to changing how people eat. Calorie restriction, low carb, keto. No matter what diet or trend or nutritionist's advice, by and large, they had one thing in common: shoulding. Nearly every suggested approach came back to my trusty medical school lecture. You should eat fewer calories. You should eat healthier food. And you should exercise more. It had become clear to me, my patients already knew what they should do. They just couldn't do it. and on top of that, felt guilty for not being able to follow their doctor's advice. What was keeping them from doing what they knew they should do? Then I had a realization, the first of many things that I learned from my patients. Many of my patients were unhappy with more than just their eating. They were unhappy because it felt like they had brought the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.